Okay, here's the deal. Over the past couple of years, there's been a trend among internet service providers to push for data caps. That is, they start charging their subscribers for the amount of data downloaded, as well as their promised service speed. Generally speaking, though, data caps suck. And they suck for three main reasons. First, they stifle innovation, communication, and expression. Second, the excuses that ISPs use to justify putting in data caps are bull, and the ISPs know it. And third, the actual purpose of a data cap is to raise revenue and prop up outdated business models. When reliable broadband became available across the United States, it really started a revolution in the way we compute. First, there's obviously the digital distribution of music, movies, TV shows, viral videos, telepresence, webinars, and of course games, what you would consider high data applications that you really can't do without broadband. But another overlooked aspect of broadband penetration was that it provided a market for new applications using web interfaces, both high data applications and low data applications. See, it created an entire industry of remote, centrally hosted applications that offer performance comparable to desktop and mainframe software, whether it was called software as a service, cloud computing, whatever. It worked. Broadband internet access brought business to the internet like nothing else could. It wasn't just the speed, but the reassurance of always-on availability and reliability of the internet connection that just couldn't be matched in the dial-up era. But when you suddenly add an additional charge based on the amount of data you transfer, a lot of that reassurance goes right out the window. In short, you make the user answer a bunch of questions that they didn't have to deal with before. Questions like, how is my throughput measured? Is it at my end or at my ISP's end? How much data do I have left before I get hit with fees? How much data will the thing I'm about to do actually use? What if I'm wrong and this is taking up a lot more data than I thought? How much will it cost if I go over? How much more data will I need this month? What if I can't process my sales reports because I spent too much data gaming? What about my friend's internet usage? Can I share this video with him, or will he not be able to see it until next month? The end result is that data caps add doubt to internet-based applications, and people will use internet applications far less often. This reverses the trend towards innovative web and mobile app-based technologies. It's not that data caps make these apps technically impossible, though some mobile caps are small enough that services such as Netflix couldn't work with them. No, it's more that they make people less comfortable with using the internet. If data caps become the new standard, the next generation of internet and mobile-based applications and communications will just never be developed and never be adopted. Now, obviously, no one actually wants caps on their internet usage. I mean, no one wants to do less for the same amount of money. So ISPs and mobile providers have to come up with excuses why they're necessary. And the most frequently cited reason for capping internet usage has typically been network congestion. In short, the argument goes like this. A small subset of heavy users uses up all the bandwidth before the average user can use some, causing congestion. But there's a big gaping hole in that theory. Networks do not work that way. See, the internet is mostly based on the TCP/IP protocol, and the TCP/IP protocol has its own ways of dealing with congestion that have nothing to do with how much data you download. Now, for some of you, this explanation I'm about to give is oversimplified, and for others it's going to be overly technical, but bear with me, I think that this is the best middle ground. TCP goes back to 1974. It was first described by Vint, Cerf, and Bob Kahn, and it works more or less like this. When an application decides to send a chunk of data, it hands it over to either a program or a piece of hardware in your computer called a TCP module. The TCP module then breaks the data into chunks called segments. The TCP segments are then placed inside an IP packet, which has information about the data's destination. It's a bit like putting a letter in an addressed envelope. The packet is sent out, and once the packet is received by the destination, an acknowledgement is sent back to the sender. Now, sometimes packets can be lost, especially if there's some sort of network congestion. So, if the original sender never receives the acknowledgement, the TCP module knows that either the packet didn't get to its destination, or that the receiver didn't send back the response in time. Either way, it then retransmits the packet. What's interesting about the TCP module is that it treats dropped packets as a sign of congestion or other network trouble, and then it scales back the rate at which it sends the data. So if there's congestion on a network link, all the TCP modules using that link scale back and slow down sending data until they all reach equilibrium. They share the pipe, and every TCP stream gets a fair share. What that means is that no matter how big the file size you're transferring or streaming is, you only take up as much bandwidth at that time as the network can support. Small files travel at the same rates as big ones. So what ends up causing congestion in most cases is not the amount of data used, but the number of people, programs, and devices using the network connection at the same time. The amount of traffic moved is not the limiting factor. The rate or speed with which the traffic moves is the limiting factor. Data caps charge you for your total traffic, not your speed. Furthermore, data caps don't tell the difference between streaming a 2-gigabyte high-definition movie during peak hours on a Thursday evening when the network is highly congested, and a 2-gigabyte file backup at 4 in the morning on a Saturday when the network isn't congested at all. So, logically, if ISPs were really concerned about congestion, they would be selling less service to fewer people, and instead of offering to upgrade people to faster speeds, they'd urge people to buy slower service when possible. But do you see Comcast or AT&T running commercials telling people not to sign up or not to buy more smartphones? Hell no. They're all advertising how fast their networks are, without telling people that while the network will be fast, you won't be able to use it for long at the advertised speed if there's a data cap. I may get a little sidetracked here because I want to take a moment to specifically address mobile broadband, because mobile broadband providers tend to have much lower data caps than most ISPs. There's a real issue with performance in mobile applications, and this is called the spectrum crunch. But the spectrum crunch has nothing to do with network capacity or data caps. Spectrum crunch is when mobile companies run out of room in the electromagnetic spectrum allocated to them by the FCC in order to have cell phone towers as far apart as they are with so many users connected at once. Again, this really doesn't have anything to do with how much data you use, only with how many people are using that connection at the same time. And ultimately, spectrum crunch will be solved either by adding more cell phone towers or by reallocating more of the electromagnetic spectrum. So, if congestion isn't the reason for data caps, what is? Well, the answer, unsurprisingly, is money. When a broadband provider institutes data caps, they make first the obvious money from overage charges, and they also tie the higher caps to the most expensive data plans. So even though you may not need the speed of a turbo service, you may be pressured to upgrade because you don't want to run out of data on your data cap. I should point out again, if ISPs were really concerned about congestion, they'd be selling less speed and encouraging users to settle for slower service. Instead, they institute policies which incentivize users to buy more speed, whether they want it or not. Indeed, according to a paper by the New America Foundation, as data usage has gone up, the cost of providing that data has gone down, and the average revenue per user has gone up for ISPs over the past 3 years, mostly due to overage charges and upselling. In other words, due to caps. There's also another reason that broadband providers may choose to implement caps. Many of the broadband providers are also in industries where they can use the cap to push their own services. For example, Comcast's on-demand video service for the Xbox 360 doesn't count against Comcast's data caps, while competing video services such as Netflix, Hulu, Apple TV, and YouTube do. Of course, the biggest service that ISPs are promoting by discouraging internet use is cable television. Comcast, AT&T, Time Warner, Cox, Verizon, they all offer cable television service. Furthermore, Comcast is owned by General Electric, which also owns the television networks of NBC Universal, and they also own Focus Features. Time Warner, they own CNN, HBO, Time, and Warner Brothers. So it's a conflict of interest for them to sell both television and broadband, because broadband has undermined the dominance television has had on American time killing. Look at Wikipedia, for example. That took hundreds of millions of man-hours to produce, edit, and curate, and it's all done by volunteers. But where did all those man-hours of productivity come from? Well, the answer is that it was once taken from the time killed in front of the television. Same with massive builds of Minecraft, people making and publishing fan fiction and fan art, people tweeting status updates, even people making animations about tech issues on YouTube. Almost all of that time spent creating, communicating, and sharing on the internet has come from time spent in front of the television. So given a choice, people are watching TV less. Now this is bad if you happen to own a cable company or a television network. So then what does a bandwidth cap really do? A bandwidth cap ultimately limits the amount of time that can be spent on the internet. That leaves people with a surplus of free time. And cable companies are hoping that they'll spend that free time in front of the television like they used to. The big reason broadband providers can and do get away with this is because we simply don't have enough competition in the U.S. telecommunications market for the market to regulate itself. And we don't have effective government regulation either. Though there is a bill in the Senate introduced by Senator Ron Wyden which would require broadband providers to get FCC approval before instituting data caps. But whether or not that bill or one like it passes, or even if it has the intended effect if it does, it behooves us, as citizens of the internet, to understand the internet's true nature before accepting bad policies, either from corporations or the government. Broadband internet is an almost magical pipe which pumps freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and freedom of assembly right to our own homes. It is more effective at creating a well-informed populace than 100 cable channels or 10,000 newspapers. What I'm saying is, it should be protected.
Mm-hmm.